great to be back at the MacArthur Memorial where I used to work. So as we used to say when I worked here, this was the first thing really downtown, the tremendous renaissance we've had, and the MacArthur Memorial in some respects started it all. So it's good to be back. And I believe these lectures are the Lewis Guy lectures. Peggy, is that right? And I would just like to say it's an honor to be here as part of that. Lewis was a friend of mine. I think he was a real prince of the city in everything that he did for Norfolk's history and for all of us, really. So as Peggy said, the impulse in writing the book was for the centennial of the Naval Station, which is coming up. And you see the picture here up on the screen is the map of the Jamestown Exposition, and you see the Sewell's Point area. This was before the Navy came, and you get a good idea of the geography of the area there. And you can see the routes, the ferry routes. Most people came to the exposition by water. So this was at the start, 1907. Here's a postcard with a rather fanciful view of the exposition piers. The exposition was open for several months in 1907. It really didn't make money the way the organizers intended. It had a checkered economic history. It did call a lot of attention to Southeast Virginia and Hampton Roads. Here you see some of the exhibition halls and another postcard and a giant teapot in case you were thirsty when you were walking around the exhibits. In naval terms, the most important thing that happened at the time of the exposition was the assembly, departure, and return of 16 battleships known as the Great White Fleet. This particular picture shows President Roosevelt on the USS Connecticut. This is actually when the fleet returned in February 1909. This was important because the area was not only the scene of a World's Fair, but the staging of an international fleet, and many important Navy people and people from the government came here, and more attention was called to the area, including the president himself several times came to the exposition, I think twice, and then for the fleet activities. So you say, what happened between 1907 and the exposition, this great World's Fair, everybody was having a lot of fun, and then suddenly the Navy came? What happened in the 10 years in between? Well, not too much. There were various ideas for what could be done with Sewell's Point to develop it, perhaps some type of commercial development. There was an attorney named Theodore Wool, who was probably the leading advocate for the Navy to take over the Sewell's Point area. He actually wrote a book himself called Reasons, and you see here, it was something he printed himself, and this was his book. He pointed out several things, that the Chesapeake Bay was normally ice free. There was plenty of vacant land. The climate, despite tonight, was mild year round, and that there were railroad and transportation networks already in place. Now, of course, the Navy was here, and the Navy has been here since the beginning of our history as a region, and the Norfolk Naval Shipyard right across the river had been established many, many years before 1907. There was a training station associated with this part of our region. It was St. Helena. It was on the site on the Elizabeth River opposite the Navy Yard, not too far from here. The top image there is a war bond rally during World War I, and the bottom, they actually, when the sailors would report to St. Helena, they actually would stay on this old USS Richmond, the receiving ship. You can imagine that was an old sailing ship converted into a type of barracks. The total capacity of St. Helena was about 3,500 men. With the beginning of the war, they began to pour in and actually were sheltered in tents. So it was with the rapid expansion of World War I that St. Helena was rapidly was going to be overgrown. Here's President Woodrow Wilson addressing Congress, the declaration of war of World War I, and a picture of him. And we were fortunate enough to have a wonderful symposium here a few months ago about World War I and tremendous accelerator of social change, and World War I was really the impulse for the naval station. There were two sites that were discussed to handle the increased training needs of the Navy, and one was on the York River up in Yorktown, the other was Sewell's Point, the Jamestown Exposition site. So Congress in June 1917 authorized President Wilson to commandeer the tract of land which had been the site of the Jamestown Exposition. The land taken over was about 474 acres, the old Jamestown Exposition grounds, another 100 acres, which was called the Pine Beach Estate, and a series of roads that had existed. The president set aside $1,200,000 to pay for the actual property and $1,600,000 for the development of the base, including storehouses, training station, and recreation grounds for fleet personnel. The occupants of Sewell's Point were given 30 days to vacate the land in 1917. And an immediate, you'll be surprised at this, I know, an immediate battle ensued where the Navy reported the value of the property to be $1,400,000, and the numerous owners concluded that their property was worth $3 million. So this legal wrangling over the Sewell's Point property actually continued for many years, and the Mr. Wolf, the attorney who wrote the book Reasons, was actually heavily involved with it. You can see what kind of condition Sewell's Point was in 1917 when the Navy arrived. It was covered with underbrush, and the remaining structures from the Jamestown Exposition were in a very poor state of repair. Most of the buildings of the expedition were torn down. There were some, of course, that remained, and you can see in this picture, these are some of the state pavilions, which we'll see a little bit later. This is actually an image of one of the state pavilions in New Hampshire House, which later, or now, in fact, is part of the street that's known as Admiral's Row. The state houses for the exposition were actually not built as residences. They were built as exhibit pavilions, and they were modeled after historic colonial homes. So there at the New Hampshire House here was modeled after a house, the Talmadge House in the state of New Hampshire. The difference was that in colonial America, no one lived in things this size. Colonial houses were quite small, so these things exploded. But in terms of their continuing history, they never were intended to be residences. And as a result was a series of maintenance nightmares for the Navy, which to some respect continued throughout the 20th century. They were not The idea when these were built was not that people would be living them 100 years hence. Here's a view of Admiral's Row, which gives you an idea of the state of the streets when the Navy came in 1917. There were excessive rains also in the naval station began, and there was many of the roads were impassable and turned completely to mud. A lot of the work was carried out by horses, working in teams, drawing supplies from the waterfront. One of the, we have at the museum a memoir of a guy named Roger Copinger, who was one of the original enlistees at the naval station, and he was very pleased. He writes that the civilian owners of the houses had moved out and left some boats for which we used to go fishing some 100 yards offshore. This was one of the centerpiece building of the exposition, which was called the auditorium. The Navy used it as an administration building, and in fact it was called the administration building. Here it is in its Navy days, and you see this is a piece from the museum collection. The handwriting there is where we go to the movies. This particular building, the one in the center, the administration building, burned down in World War II. The two wings on either side of it are still on the naval station there. All the buildings on the naval station have alphanumeric designators. These happen to be known as N-21 and N-23. The commander, Navy Region Mid-Atlantic, is actually headquartered in building N-23. When the Navy took these buildings over, they were torn down to the brick wall and rebuilt from the inside. Here's another view This is showing what's now the front of the building. In the exposition, it was the back of the building because the exposition was facing the water. Now, within a period of 30 days, housing for 7,500 men was constructed. If you think about that, 30 days, that's rather incredible. That includes barracks buildings, lavatories, storehouses, water systems, lighting, roads, and walks. They also, workers had to build 3 miles of standard gauge railroad to access the base and clear 400 acres of ground covered with underbrush. We saw a picture of that earlier. They also constructed a boiler plant for steam making with 6 500 horsepower water tube boilers. So on October 12, 1917, about 4 months from the date of the approval, the 1st Regiment from St. Helena moved in with appropriate ceremonies. This was about 1,700 men. By November 1918, there were almost 13,000 sailors at Sewell's Point. And here are some of the guys, and they were guys then. Seaman Coppinger, who we talked about a moment ago, wrote that we all slept in hammocks and marched to and from school, barracks, and the mess hall. Some of us were not used to this kind of living, and the rest of us enjoyed hearing them fall out of their hammocks every night. One is hungry by the time one gets to eat at the end of this line. One of the newer buildings was the electrical school. This building is also still on the naval station. It was designed and with a series of boilers that the students operated, and the steam produced by the boilers was used to power generators that were used for classes by other students. There were classes in all types of electrical appliances, storage batteries, gas engines. This is a group of students at the Forge School. The picture on the bottom is another type of electrical school. It's an especially interesting building, a battleship-shaped building on land known as the USS Electrician. It also had classrooms. It's gone now, which is a shame. It'd be a good place for the museum in some ways. It had searchlights, signals, cranes, moving turrets, and ventilating devices, as well as fully operational electrical systems. It's a lot safer to train in something like this than it would have been on a real ship. The picture above I just put as kind of a contrast. There were still seamanship and sailing classes on the naval station. Part of the naval station was also an air station founded with the Naval Air Detachment of officers, students, and mechanics from the Curtiss Airplane Company from Newport News. Now, in 1910, a few years before this and before Sewell's Point, the first man to fly an airplane off a ship did it off of Fort Monroe and landed in Willoughby Spit. His name was Eugene Ely. So this was an impetus for the Naval Air Station in Hampton Roads. You can see at the tent temporary canvas hangers at the bottom of the picture there. This is a slightly different view. The two piers there are the old government piers from the Jamestown Exposition. This is also the air station side of the naval station. It's a good image because you can see some of the dredging operations that were used to fill out the base. About 8 million yards of dredging were performed all around Sewell's Point. There was two contractors performed this work for $2.3 million. They used suction dredges, which pumped through pipelines behind bulkheads until they got 10 feet of elevation, above low water. And you can see there, the beginning, sort of the center of the picture is the beginning of the fill. Here's another view of the same area. And if you look at the top of the picture there, you can see it's getting filled in a little bit more. This was a little bit later, some of the permanent buildings from the air station. And I'll talk about this a little bit later. This was the aircraft repair facility. By the end of 1917, the Navy had H-12 and H-16 seaplanes. They had also had other types of flying boats. And as a result, they had increased air operations, 4 hangars, an administration building, a dispensary, and there was a flying boat that went between Norfolk and Washington, D.C. in 2 hours and 30 minutes. How great would it be to have that service return? Here's another image of the aircraft operating. During World War I, the purpose of the air station was to train student officers, the repair and maintenance of the aircraft, and also patrol flights on the Eastern Seaboard. There was also a tremendous amount of experimental work on seaplane operation and experiments using equipment like radios, motors, and stabilizing devices. There were about 1,000 men assigned to the air station at the time of the war. One of the more interesting and romantic features of the naval station in World War I was the lighter and air division, which included dirigibles and balloons, primarily used for patrol work. You see this enormous hangar there. This is one of the Navy airships, C-3, which was built in 1918. This was a huge aircraft, 192 feet long, 50 feet high, actually caught fire above the city in 1921 due to leaking hydrogen. The crew did escape before it exploded. This was a tremendous hazard of the lighter-than-aircraft program. We've been talking about the air station side of the naval station. This is the other side. This actually is the Pine Beach Hotel, which was one of the structures that had survived the Jamestown Exposition, first used as a general residence when the base opened, but later as part of the supply section. The fleet needed millions of square feet for the storage of supplies. They needed cold storage, an ice manufacturing plant, a place for non-perishable materials, and constructed a series of frame temporary storehouses followed by more permanent storehouses. You see in the foreground there, there's the big roofs. Those are some of the supply buildings. And this is gives another good indication of how much the Sewell's Point area expanded, and the original waterfront is that you see in this picture, the piers now are, you can see, have been all filled in. You'll see a picture of the modern looking base in a minute. The flats here in the foreground were all filled in. This is one of the original pier buildings, Pier 2. The original piers were 125 feet wide and 1,400 feet long, and the amount of money to construct these original six piers was about $3 million. So what was the point of all the activity at Sewell's Point? The answer was, as it is today, service to the fleet. This is the American fleet arriving in Scapa Flow and some of the World War I era battleships. The entire complex was devoted to serving the Navy supply needs, training. There was also a submarine base, and the Navy's greatest success in World War I was delivering the American Expeditionary Force overseas. Now here we see Sewell's Point today, and I wish I was more graphically able because I draw a little outline on this picture, but the original footprint of Sewell's Point is very much smaller than the naval station that you see here today. Just wanted to conclude my formal remarks with the talk about a little program that we're working on. Is there anybody here who worked at NADEP? Okay. One of the features of the original naval station was the aircraft and repair facility, which was later known as ONR, later known as the Naval Air Rework Facility, or NARF, and later known as the Naval Aviation Depot, NADEP. It closed after almost decades and decades of service in 1996. It was the largest employer in Hampton Roads. That figure there is Bucky the Beaver. If someone had raised their hand, they would have had to identify Bucky the Beaver, so it's good that no one did. We are working with a series of veterans of NADEP on commemorating their work and at NADEP or at the NARF. And in 1916, we're going to be working on this. If you know anyone who has some experience there or a neighbor, a friend who worked there and wishes to get involved with some of the commemoration of this, come to the museum and let us know. There's one of our very, very able volunteers, Mr. Lou Gull, is heading this up. I don't see Lou here tonight, but this is something that we're going to do that's going to then carry us into the centennial of the naval station, which throughout has really become one of the most important naval installations in the entire world, and certainly been a driver of the economy here in the city, and has really been bringing to us all. Well, we do have some of the books for sale, and I should tell you that the proceeds do go to our wonderful partners at the museum, the Hampton Roads Naval Historical Foundation, who are basically doers of good deeds to support us in some of the programs that you will see on our calendar of events out there. And I would like to personally thank Peggy for being such a wonderful city historian and hostess.